Toga is one of those characters that doesn't need any information in order to be interesting. Crazy, psychotic anime girls just do well in the anime world. That's just simply a fact. But more information is always welcome, especially if it paints that crazy character in an even crazier position, and you don't really get too much in a show like My Hero Academia if they have what normally should be a bloodthirsty, insane, psychotic character. You don't usually get those moments to build up to what made them either snap or become who they are. And the idea that she always was kind of like that, and that it really was just a mask suppressing her natural desire, which was the blood. I mean, the moments where you see her holding like a baby bird and how she's like gnawing at it, just wanting to suck its blood, the parents visibly calling her a monster, which there's been some pretty questionable parental things in this show that are like, you definitely are responsible. But I mean, it's hard to really say the mother and father, for being ashamed of what they made, sucking blood and having like this menacing Joker-like smile. Well, yeah, maybe different parental things might have turned out differently, you could argue. I mean, it's hard not to say, like, can really any of us say if we had a kid who was sucking bloods of dead animals and, ended up finally snapping and, after killing someone, sucking their blood through a straw, we wouldn't say they're a monster? Most of us probably would. I mean, this episode was an absolute bloodbath. I mean, this, unless I'm misremembering, like, this is the most, like, death-filled episode My Hero Academia has seen to date. Between Shigaraki apparently no longer needing to touch people in order to turn them into stone to then dead, which says to me that honestly, Deku and pals are in for a rude awakening when they fight them. Which, honestly, this episode did a great job at making me root for Shigaraki and company while forgetting that I shouldn't root for them because the better they do, the worse off it will be for the heroes of the show. But leave it to My Villain Academia to make you switch perspectives. I mean, the idea that when Toga was kind of like on her last, I think, hurrah, she was like moments away from death and she used the blood, and the fact that she not only can just turn into them, she can use their abilities as well, given the kind of like power up, I guess you could say. The life or death situations, I mean, it's a trope we see time and time again in shows like My Hero Academia, but I think it kind of works given the circumstances and the intense shit they've been through over so long and what we know about metas and things like that and how they can evolve, right? But the idea that you pretty much just have someone who seems pretty normal at a static level, she looks like someone who would just be a reporter, and the shit she's saying is the complete opposite of the physical appearance we see. The fact that she's just going in for a scoop, I don't know if I'm the only one feeling this, but did that not feel like basically a shot at the media and how like paparazzis and how like reporters, I use that in quotations because let's be honest, most reporters aren't actually all that intelligent. They will go after the scoop no matter what. And yeah, I know Toga is essentially an evil character given the maniac blood sucking, but still, like, this is someone who very much feels like a shot at those media people who don't give a shit about human compassion and will do anything for the scoop, right? I don't know if that was just me, but I like that nonetheless. And just the buildup of her, like, honestly, I wasn't expecting her to kind of get slammed as hard as she did. I mean, there's moments where, like, prior to her, like, almost getting exploded, right? Where she uses her masks, which are like these syringes that go in every which direction, and I thought it was a pretty cool weapon. I mean, the idea that you'd be able to absorb it that way, you probably are filling up vials for later use, and then that blood is exploding because these people are so deranged that they're willing to be suicide bombs for the cause. And seriously, the liberation cause is kind of frightening. These are people who have been training day in and day out. And seriously, that's pretty goddamn frightening. I mean, just seeing what, like, and you kind of can even compare to, like, real life movements in the world, right? Where people really get, like, so enthralled in their vision. Imagining people who had superpowers with that, it's pretty frightening what could happen. And you could see the chess pieces being laid in terms of how someone with a pretty good iron fist could manipulate the masses, as we see day in and day out throughout our own history, right? So the fact that, twice as an example is a key component to keeping that vision alive in terms of like the duplicates so they don't lose leaders and things like that, but characters like Toga we don't need to keep alive, and like, it's kind of insane because this arc really has done a great job at making you, I think, forget who the heroes and villains are. Because We shouldn't root for Shigaraki and company because they will cause very bad things to happen to Deku and company. But at the same time, when you're it's not like we're watching them just go up against every average day Joes, right? We're watching them go up against someone who it's easy to like say which one you think is crazier. And at times you kind of flip-flop, I find. But it's easy to see these group of lunatics rampaging the streets, and it's hard not to feel giddy. Similar to when an All Might fight's happening, that you're like, yeah, Shigaraki, yeah, Touka, kick some ass. And then I'm like, wait a second, should I be saying this as bodies are literally hitting the floor? I mean, that scene, just seeing the difference in how an ability is used, someone who normally would like send opponents away, and then the fact that she just left them hanging and they all fall and it's like a fountain of blood. I wasn't expecting that. I really wasn't. Like, I was expecting probably some to have snap necks. I just wasn't expecting the whole army there. And it's gonna be interesting. That's, I think, the best way to say it. I mean, I love this show. I love this episode. I'm loving this arc. I'm genuinely curious though, because if you look at the situation, now I didn't watch the preview if there was one. I think there was a preview this time. But you would think that situations are being painted like Toga's gonna die, Twice will probably be removed from the equation, Shigaraki's probably gonna come in and destroy a bunch of people. But there's actually a chance for some of these characters in the League of Villains to end up dead. I wouldn't have said after last week's episode with how the plan was being set in motion, but seeing the level of like soldiers they have to throw at them, even though if they can hold out long enough, Big Man's gonna come in and destroy everything seemingly, right? And when he's exhausted, they can take him out. But at the same time, there's actually a threat of certain enemies you'd normally root for to fall. Now I find myself rooting to succeed, even though logically I know I should push back again. So it's gonna be interesting if they all get out of this one alive, and most likely this entire group of lunatics probably ending up dead. I mean, you don't show as much death in this episode as you did, unless, you know, you're gonna commit to probably most of them, if not all of them, ending up dead. But at the same time, it feels like with whatever happens with the victory of Shigaraki and company, it's probably gonna have like a sigh of relief slash worry where you realize what we just saw is what's gonna happen to Deku and company. And I'm waiting for that moment. It's probably gonna shake me to my core, I gotta be honest, but I'm kind of excited and terrified to see what's gonna happen there. I have to give major props to the comment section last week. I mean, you can go look. The top comments on last week's video range from people, you know, having issues, loving it completely, and it's respectable. I mean, it's hard to find that type of shit online anymore, but I do think it's a mixture of, you know, people understanding that, you know, toxicity doesn't help anything, right? If you have issues, explain your issues without being an asshole about it. And we need more of that shit, especially in communities like My Hero Academia. So as much as I'd love to say it's, oh, it's because of me, no, it's because you guys are actually intelligent and you know how to communicate. So props to you guys. You guys deserve a hell of a lot of support for the way you actually talk about your issues rather than just, you know, simply throwing random slangs online because, you know, that's an easy buzzword to get those clicks and headlines, right? Let me know what you're feeling, though, on this week's episode of the second episode of My Villain Academia. I'd love to know because there's, I mean, last week had a wide variety of opinions that I loved reading, so I'd love to hear the same down below. Leave a like if you enjoyed, subscribe if you're new around here. So until next time, everyone, please take care and have a good one.